the means of production and control of the means of production. The fact is that we are all using the means of production. Our computers are in front of us. Mm-hmm. This is a very significant means of production. And I say it repeatedly, work is not something you go to. Work is something you do, and where you work and how you work is so very flexible today, and something we need to be really looking at. And I agree with you. Sean Peter talks about creative destruction. Mm-hmm. This is creative destruction in action as we speak. And there is opportunity for us to be ahead of the curve. Seth also talks about that markets listen. This is a listening opportunity and an opportunity to take advantage of the crisis. Don't waste the crisis. So I agree with you 100%. Richard, unmute and let's hear from you. Unmute your mic.
All right. Thank you. And good morning, everyone. Good morning. I know the participants who have gone before me and those who are in the call. I don't believe that I'm familiar with everyone. So by way of introduction, I'm Richard Rambaran. I am the executive director of the Chamber of Commerce here in Guyana. And I am also an adjunct professor of economics. So I'm in and around that field. So I have quite a bit of a unique vantage point when looking at enterprises. But I've been following these panel discussions for the past couple of days, and it is noteworthy to mention that I see a particular trend emerging here. And it's a discussion quite often on how corporations are viewing the environment and how corporations in particular are responding. So that's a very important point. And I do take comfort in the fact that concepts like Schumpeter's creative destruction and Christensen's disruptive innovation are coming to fore now, because we must view this as being more of an opportunity as opposed to solely being a crisis. So with that, I also want to support the conjectures made previously that work is being changed, the dynamic of work in the globe is evolving. But what I find particularly pervasive in the Caribbean is a major problem where corporations are very inward looking, and they tend to focus solely on how they operate and their degree of productivity. So one of the things that I'm hoping comes out of this period is that corporations understand, and particularly begin to evolve their strategies in planning, etc., and pay keen attention to what is happening in the environment around them. You know, oftentimes corporations end up becoming almost isolated in the sense that they are focused so much on increasing productivity and grinding output out of their resources that they have, that they miss many of these instances and events which are happening around. And this one, I believe, has caught a lot of people with their pants down, for a better expression, and for them to try to respond. Some of them, you find that they are really lagging behind. So I want to structure what I'm going to say today in two parts. And my first engagement here, I want to particularly focus on the historical context of a crisis of this nature and the context that emerges for a country like Guyana. So I want to say there are a lot of comparisons that are being made with this crisis and the 1918 influenza pandemic that besieged England and the rest of the world. But it's important to note that during that period, a lot of the unemployment, etc., was being offset by wartime production. So that resulted in an absorptive capacity in the economy, which is a bit different from what we're seeing here today. There are also comparisons to the 2008 crisis, which in my view is an incorrect assertion, because in this crisis, it's as a result of social distancing that you find aggregate demand beginning to shrink. The fact that people actually have to stay home. In the 2008 crisis, it was much different than that, because there was no physical limitation on the way that consumers can purchase. So that is a very important point to note for enterprises moving forward, because how you deliver your goods and services to consumers in the near term has to evolve, and how that evolution actually is guided into more of a long-term type of structure, one would have to necessarily look at the cost effectiveness, etc. So I just want to say that within that globalized environment, we are not isolated from what is happening in the rest of the world. We certainly are interrelated in a globalized environment. And this crisis is something that is really unprecedented, I would reckon to say, at least within the past 5 to 6 decades in the global history of the economy. So what this does, particularly for underdeveloped countries and underdeveloped private sectors that we face across the Caribbean and even some of the Latin American countries, is that it underscores for those enterprises and for those organizations who are engaged in lobbying and advocacy through the chambers of commerce, etc., it underscores the importance of public policy and a good governance environment, public governance environment, for boosting private sector development. The reason for that is that we can see that in periods of real contraction or periods of severe or acute recessions, many of these companies evolve from having just a private motive to having now a public motive also involved, because many persons within populations are not just looking for corporations to provide goods and services solely, but they're also looking to corporations to provide a public good of ensuring that persons remain employed and have a certain quantum of income as time progresses. So with that, I want to emphasize that enterprises, private enterprises, during these times of crisis and during these economic downturns, do also transform their role in the economy from just an output and productivity machinery to something that is more of a public good, because you see that employment aspect, you see that corporate social responsibility aspect, you see the dependence on firms to ensure that dynamic supply chains globally are met. Things that ministries of public health and CDCs regionally and globally cannot do as efficiently because simply of the management structure. Now, I want to just offer those as prefatory remarks in that regard, but I want to bring particular context to the nature of Guyana. And I want to say that whilst across the Caribbean, you would find that corporations have disaster risk management plans and contingency plans for instances like this, countries like Guyana, who are not traditionally countries that face natural disasters, they do not have disaster risk management plans. And many of them at this point find themselves in a situation where they don't know where to go, and they're now trying to catch up with the learning curve. So I hope that this crisis actually acts as the impetus for ensuring that corporations within Guyana, within the parameters of the Caribbean region, who do not have disaster risk management plans, etc., do find it necessary to have this in place. Countries like Guyana and other Caribbean countries who are not afflicted by hurricanes and other natural phenomena on a consistent or a continuous basis, do find themselves in a position where they don't understand business continuity, and they don't understand how the structures should be moving forward. So the last point which I want to make in this regard, and that would draw me to the close of my introduction for today's discussion, is the fact that an underdeveloped business environment, and this is also a very important lobbying point and an important point for the private sector moving forward in its discourse with governments. An underdeveloped private sector, what you find is that the quantum of liquidity that is available for that private sector entity to use is severely diminished if the environment which the entity has to operate in is underdeveloped or is anemic. The reason for that is oftentimes the services and the public goods that governments are supposed to be providing now have to be subsumed into part of an entity's budget, which in essence reduces the amount of excess liquidity that the firm may have in a reserve for contingency. What does that mean? Let me bring it to a practical example. You may have a firm who, in a well-functioning society, as opposed to a backward economy, in a well-functioning society, can depend on public security. They can depend on the police force, for example, or the police service to respond to criminal acts. They can depend on a government to have a fiscal policy that accommodates business. They can depend on public goods, for example, water, road, lights outside of their business to ensure security and such the like. They can expect those public goods to be in place. However, in situations like, or in economies like Guyana, where you face an underdevelopment of these and you have antagonistic outlook towards businesses, you'll find that many of these entities have to take their own financing and now finance private security firms. They now have to put the street lights outside of their own entities. They now have to try to find a way to work around an aggressive fiscal policy that tries to extract more revenue out of the enterprise and thus affecting its liquidity. So I want to say that this crisis and its acute nature, and compounded by the anemic form of governments and government's approach in the Caribbean region, and particularly the Anglophonic Caribbean region, really does underscore the importance for pro-private sector development policies. So that, I believe, is one of the critical points coming out of this, this entire structure. Now, the second part of what I want to speak on, and I will if I do get the opportunity subsequently, is how as a region do we recover from something like this? Mm-hmm. So I want to offer those as prefatory remarks, just to give a little bit of historical and regional context to what we're discussing, because I haven't heard that particular element coming out over the discourse mm-hmm. in the past few days. So I'll offer those as my prefatory, and thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.